Operation, Heather, that's Bourne. Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is the 1st of February, 2017. And we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 o'clock Eastern on the Nonpartisan Liberty for All media and radio network, which now runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And you can listen to the live stream on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. We are always happy to hear from you. You can reach us at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664, or via Skype. I'm not logged into Skype, but I will right now. Username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And you can, of course, check us out at our official website, Nonpartisan Liberty for All, which, among other things, like links to all our social media, we have original articles / blogs and lots of other stuff there for you to check out, along with the live stream and other miscellaneous things. So check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. I'm great at multitasking, but not when I'm on the air. So I'm trying to get the sound higher because when I listened to the last show to test the sound, I had to put the volume, at least on YouTube. See, this is maybe a problem with having it on so many different platforms. On YouTube, it wasn't loud enough where you had to turn it up. And it's better, you'd rather have it not loud enough because you can always go and, you know, mess with it and increase the sound and make it higher. Once you like overmodulate it and it's all fucked up, it's done. So I don't want to make it too loud, but I don't want to make it too soft neither. And I've been trying to get just the right perfect sound. At some point I had the settings perfect and then they got fucked up. But, so I'm kind of messing with where my sound's at now to make it. I want to make it louder. I just don't want to over modulate it where it's like, you know, you can, I think I can't really explain it, but I think people know what I mean, where it's too, like over equalized or whatever, or so I'm trying not to do that and at the same time make it louder. Basically keep the same tone and pitch and make it louder without over making it too loud, where then you know, the sound gets all fucked up and whatever. So I'll have to remember what I did today, so if it doesn't come out exactly how I want it, I can go back and change some of those things. I put some compression on it, so maybe that will help. Anyway, thanks for tuning in. Today we are going to talk about, and I apologize for not, originally I was going to do this show yesterday, and I know we've kind of been all over the place as far as doing shows and not doing it every Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And for right now, the Monday show, The Illumination Hour with Ellen Stallone, is on hiatus. I don't know for how long, as she has some, not personal issues. She's going to college and she has some, you know, things that she needs to focus on right now. And she goes in and puts a lot of work into her show and does the editing and production and all of that stuff. So it's a lot of work for her. And not that I'm saying it's not a lot of work for other people that do a show, and like it's not a lot of work for me neither, but you know, I don't go back and I do it live and that's it, and it is what it is. She records it and then goes in and edits it and puts in sound effects and does all this cool stuff. So she really puts a lot of work into it, and does a great show. So I'm disappointed, but I totally understand. And hopefully she'll be back soon. But she's got to do what she's got to do. So I'm not mad at Ellen or anything. I just really like having the show on the network. So I hope she returns very soon, and hopefully she will. And until then, hopefully we can get by with just Nonpartisan Liberty for All on the network until something else comes along. And I'll try to be more consistent. It's just hard, again, with getting... I think the biggest thing for me is making sure that I feel comfortable enough that I have enough information on the show I'm doing. I don't want to do a show that I don't know anything about. And a lot of times I do more philosophical stuff than factual things, and I do a lot based on opinion that includes fact, but I mean, it's, you know, taking facts and coming to a conclusion or an opinion based on those facts. So depending on what show I'm doing or what topic I'm doing, you know, it depends on how much research I need to do, because some of it I've, you know, done already, just by the books I've read or articles or whatnot. And that is the case really with today's show, although I did some, you know, research as well. Not as much as I'd like to do done, but there are topics that we kind of covered before, just not in this format and all together like this. And what really is starting to, well, it's not like I didn't foresee this anyway, but it's concerning. Even though that it's something that I saw coming, I mean, it's something that everybody has seen coming for years, and it's been going on for years anyway. So, but not to the extent that it is now. And of course, I'm talking about the police and they've been militarizing. That's something that's really the only thing that I think is different now. As far as how the police violate people's rights and kill people and all of that stuff, I don't think anything's really changed since the inception of a police department. And I believe it's just that we didn't know about it, because I think throughout history and think about incidences that we do know about, like Serbico, which is now, you know, over 40 years ago, and, you know, other things that have happened over the course of history with officers being corrupt or being charged with crimes or beating people or whatever, Rodney King, but even further back. And the difference now, of course, as we've always talked about, is everybody has a camera and we have the internet, so we're able to see all this stuff, and we have independent media, where before they wouldn't cover this stuff. Now, people can say the news media was better and more truthful in the past, but how do you really know? And when you look at some things, or had more, credibility, not only credibility, they did have more credibility, because now they have none, but that they were more well-respected and that they actually had integrity. Now, did they? I don't know. I think that's true, that they did to an extent, but the CIA has been sending interns to TV stations since TV news started, and even in the 20s in Hollywood. So you got to factor that in, that there was definitely stories that weren't covered, I believe, even though I think they would have went further back then, but they could get away with not covering shit because we're not going to find out about it anyway. And you look at some of these things we find out about now. Who covered, you know, MK Ultra? They didn't cover that shit. Actually, that's not true. I want to take that back. The whole reason why MK Ultra even came out was because of one journalist. But that was more of an independent guy. And then you have people like, even recently, somewhat recently, Gary Webb, who somehow shot himself twice in the head, which is bullshit, and exposed the, didn't totally expose them because that was already kind of out there, but I think he confirmed a lot of things with the Iran-Contra and the CIA funneling cocaine. And really, I don't believe he wrote this, but coming to the conclusion, and I don't know if this has ever been admitted, but it's just an obvious fact that, I mean, if they're selling cocaine, where's the money going? Well, obviously it's going to the CIA. And if you look at how many things that we find out now, that's the other thing. We can look through history and find out all the unclassified documents and all this stuff. And none of this stuff came up in the news media. So is it that they just couldn't, there were things that they're not going to find out, or that maybe they found out about it and didn't cover it? And what about JFK? I mean, the coverage on that at the time. Now, it's not something, I obviously wasn't alive and didn't see it, but from what I understand, it wasn't covered the way it should have been, that it was covered from the standpoint of, oh, Oswald did it and that's it. And Jim Garrison, the DA, who the only one to bring a case against somebody who they actually later declassified that he was connected to the CIA, Clay Shaw. I always mix up his, because he had his alias, Clay Bertrand. But if you've seen the movie JFK, he was played by Tommy Lee Jones. So people look back and think the media was great back then, but were they really? And I think, yeah, they probably were better than they are now. They probably had more integrity to an extent. But how much? Who really knows? I mean, again, we didn't have all the independent media that we have now, that's on the internet. We didn't have cameras everywhere. We didn't have all of these things that get reported because of that. So we don't know. I mean, we can look back and see that there's a lot of stuff that they never found out. Now, was that just that they didn't find out because the government was good with keeping secrets, or because they didn't do their jobs? So anyway, that's a totally different, well, it's not totally different. It kind of connects to this. So we're at a point now where it's back to, in my opinion, that there's all this support for the police. Black Lives Matter has basically been discredited by their own doing. And the whole thing turned into something it was not. Now, you had the police killing people of all races, although they didn't cover it. And you look at the news, I mean, the amount that the government media covered was only a couple. And it, I talked about this when it happened. It's like they covered strategic ones. Now, part of it was because of riots, but there were so many that were just obvious that you basically, it could have been covered from a side of, look at all these, you know, showing and focusing on all the ones that were so obvious, that were caught on video, that the majority of people that seen it or heard about it would right away be on the side of the person that got killed. But what the media did was pretty much the opposite, except maybe for Eric Garner, and that was just kind of, they couldn't really avoid that, but they didn't give it the coverage that they gave to Michael Brown. And of course, that's the one they wanted to cover. Why? Because it wasn't a clear case. There was so much information from different people as to what happened. And, you know, I don't believe they say, well, the Justice Department investigated it and this is what they came up with and whatever. And it, that doesn't mean anything to me, to be honest. You can't, maybe that's how it happened. Maybe it's not. But that really is irrelevant. The point was that they had a case that would easily divide people. Instead of taking a case that most people would look at and say, what the fuck? They just murdered that person. And there's plenty of them out there. I mean, it happens every day. Not all of them are on video. And of course, the police are going to lie. But like, they didn't cover the one I always talk about, is Samantha Ramsey. You didn't see that on government media, with the girl that got, you know, shot point blank through her windshield. She was 19 because the cop jumped on the car. Now, there's video of right before, But even going into, if you look at the video before and the story the cop gave and the story the witnesses gave, that got no attention from government media. And the reason was because it didn't fit into the narrative. So before I get into all of this, I kind of want to go back to the point and what they're trying, what I believe that the purpose of this is, because this is pretty much controlled, in my opinion. And that's not a conspiracy theory. I mean, it's being, you know, all these groups are funded. So, or government, or their government media, one or the other. So my whole thing is that, first of all, no one's talking about the police anymore, really. Black Lives Matter came out with their agenda, their front, their socialist front, really, there to promote socialists and even communist values, that it's not even about the police. And I think that was totally on purpose, of course. But before I get into all of this, I want to look at and talk about why did they do the things that I'm going to, I guess, accuse them of doing, which I kind of have in previous shows, certain parts. Like I talked about Black Lives Matter once they came out with their agenda being really just a front for communist propaganda, because you look at who they're funded by, that they're, you know, they were given millions of dollars. The same applies to the women's group. I mean, there's an agenda that's being pushed, and it's being funded by what I call the powers that be, who also control the media, that wants to. So I look at this is all part, whether it's Black Lives Matter, the way that they covered Michael Brown and a couple of the other people that were killed, because again, they didn't really cover much when it comes to people that were killed. If you talk about government media, when you have something like, you know, 1400 minimum a year. Now, some of those, the average person would say they're justified. The amount that actually the police are fired at, which is the only justifiable shootings, in my opinion, is very small. And I talked about before that I took a sample of maybe 100 and went through them. And I could, you know, really do the research and go through every single one, and I guarantee you it'd probably be 1%. Now, that doesn't mean that they didn't have a gun. I'm talking about people that actually shot at the police. And then if you go to people that even pointed their gun at the police, it's a small percentage. And the percentage of people that have gun that had a gun is a little higher. But, and this is really just off the top of my head, I would, based on the information I looked at, and again, this is not a, I wouldn't look at this as a fact or a, you know, this is more, not more, this is my opinion based on what I looked at. So it's based on facts, but it's still an opinion, that maybe 20% of the people killed by the police have a gun, maybe even less, even have one. But the pointing and firing is really small, and pointing is a little more. But again, you have the Detroit Threat Management Center, which I've talked about a bunch of times, had Dale Brown on the show, who we had talked about having him do a show. And then, I don't know, he's been so busy and we just never got it together. But he was able to protect people and keep them safe. And he's been shot at before. I think he's been shot. I know some of his people have been shot. None of the people they were protecting have been ever been injured or hurt in any way. But when they had guns, now they don't even have guns, and they do this without even having guns at this point. But they did it when they used guns, with the rule that you do not fire until fired upon. And that alone, you're not going to shoot somebody with a fake gun. You're not going to shoot somebody that's just, they suicide by cop but doesn't want to hurt anybody, or somebody who's really not going to fire a gun or has an unloaded gun, but they're just, you know, trying to do whatever with it. Like I said, it could be because they want to get killed by the police on purpose or whatever. So the only reason I believe that a cop should be able to shoot at somebody is if they're fired upon first. There's some extenuating circumstances. There could be, you know, like 0.5% of the time or something, that something happens where that may not, you know, be the case, where it's justifiable and they didn't shoot at them. But I would say the majority of cases, looking at a lot of them and just being police, I don't care if you're able to protect yourself or not, because if you're not, then you shouldn't be a cop. That's the whole point. Cops should be held to a higher standard than the average person. So I would not say that, although some people would, I would not hold a average person to that standard, because they're not part of the government. They don't have the powers that the police have. So if someone breaks in your house and you shoot them, although it's tragic and I would try to avoid doing that, and it's not something to be happy about or proud of, but you don't do anything wrong. Or if somebody's attacking you, you know, hitting you, and you're getting attacked and you shoot them, I believe that people have the right to defend themselves from attacks. Now, police, because of the powers that they have, because they're supposed to be trained, should be able to deal with 99.9% of those situations without using their gun, unless they're being shot at. So I don't view many shootings as justifiable. But my point being is that they showed ones to a shooting like what happened with Michael Brown is one that would divide people. And as I was saying, I talked about that. I did a whole show on it. You can go back to the Spreaker archives and find that. And also on the BLM when their agenda came out. But sorry, I got sidetracked. So before we get to that, though, that I believe all of this and what has happened, because you look at the end goal or end, not end goal, but you look at where we're at now compared to where we were in 2012 or 2013 when you had and you still have them, but how popular Cop Block was, and they may still be as popular. I just don't really follow them much anymore. But it was an issue that was building for all people, that the, and I'm not just talking about people getting killed by police, because if you really look at it, the amount of people that get killed, because I talk about the total population and the, you know, the amount of people that get killed, it's not a lot, but it's a lot to be killed by the government and by, you know what I mean? So even though percentage wise, it's tiny, but it's huge to me that that many people, you know, 1,400 or so people are killed by the government that we know of, first of all, and the government's police. It's insane. Now, again, when you look at the amount of deaths, it's the total deaths, it's not even, you know, it's under a percent, way under. So, but because we're talking about the government, and because we're talking about the government's monopoly on force and the power that the police have, it is a big deal if you kill over 1,000 people. It's a big deal if you kill over 100 people. If it was like 10 and all of them had shot at police and they shot back, I wouldn't say police murder of people, because that's what a lot of it is, as far as I'm concerned, is an issue. But it's an issue, that many people. Now, this whole thing that people tell their kids and saying that, oh, I could be killed by the police, really, your chances of getting killed by the police because of the percentage and whatnot are slim. But it can happen. It's more apt to happen than a terrorist attack or a school shooting. Yet people are fucking always talking about trying to ban guns and school shootings and things like that. More people get killed by police than in school shootings. More people get killed by police than terrorist attacks. A lot more. And I think even the number that is a accurate number that can be backed up, there's more that don't get reported because the police take people out, like in Vegas, and bury them in the desert or something like that. I'm not saying that happens often, but I wouldn't be surprised if there are a certain amount, and it would, if they did that, they do it to people that they could probably just easily get away with it. I mean, they get away with shit all the time anyway, but most likely people that if they disappeared, no one would be looking for them or whatever. But they could probably get away with doing it to anybody, to be honest, as they get away with it now. And it's not that they're getting away with it. I read the law in Nevada. They don't really, based on the Nevada state law, and I'm sure every state is pretty similar, police are really given the legal authority pretty much to shoot anybody for almost any reason, because it's all perception. It's basically you just say you felt threatened, or you felt, you know, that you were in danger. It's funny because I was watching the movie Colors a couple days ago. I mean, I've seen it before, but, and the cop shot a guy for reaching for his pants. People who've seen the movie, they probably remember the scene, and there was this big hearing and whatever, and I don't even know if they showed what ended up happening. I don't think they did. I mean, they showed part of the hearing and they're, you know, saying you killed a man for reaching for his pants and, you know, angry about it and whatnot. And I don't even think they would give a shit. It's funny that you see cops arrested for certain crimes if they commit an actual crime. But when it comes to their job, while they're in the process of doing their job and violating people's rights, that's when they don't. You never see them getting into trouble for that, or very rarely. And if they do, they usually get off because the system is designed that way. And they have they're immune on so many things, and there's no accountability or responsibility or any of that. But as I always talk about, I believe the goal of any government, despite what they say, and again, look up the definition of government, any definition of government has control in it. And it's to take control over everyone and everything. That everything to be run by government, including your life. Now, I don't mean directly you have somebody from the government right there and, you know, but a 1984 type scenario where, you know, everybody, it's dictated to people what job they work, everything they do is tracked, all of that. And a lot of that is already happening already. So essentially, as I talk about, is that it's, you know, the U.S. government wants to keep an illusion of freedom, and they've done that, and they've done it in a way that was very smart, where they never came out and said, had a dictator or anything like that. They did it generationally, over generations. They've done this. They've took more and more freedom away, leading to that goal. And this, I think, started at the beginning. And you can look, I mean, you can look at the quote-unquote founders in different ways. You can look at them as a group of rich, elite, white men. And the white really, well, it's relevant because of in the Constitution, how black people were only 3/4 of the population, and slavery wasn't abolished as part of the formation of the country and all of that. So, but I think now it's not as important. It's more about the elite. As I was hearing somebody talk about racism and that black people can't be racist because they don't have the power or whatever. And, you know, I'm thinking about it. I'm like, the majority of white people, unless you're rich or part of the government, you don't have any power. They don't have any power to do anything to people, black people, neither. So I don't know. But anyway, so that you can look at them as people that designed this from the beginning to be a society that was for the elite to rule, to take control over everything at some point. Now you have the Bill of Rights, you have all these things, but they needed those because they needed that illusion of freedom. So I'm not saying I look at it that way. I think there were some people like Jefferson, for example, that generally believed in freedom and didn't really even want a government. But if you look at it as a whole, I mean, that's who made the decisions. What, you had 30 people that made decisions for 7 million or minus, you know, 7 million minus 30, whatever. The population supposedly back then was about 7 million for the colonies. So you had them essentially make those decisions for the majority of people. And that's, and they essentially overthrew the government. They sort of followed the rules for it because originally there were the Articles of Confederation, and they kind of overthrew that for the Constitution. And the whole reason they did that is because they felt that the federal government didn't have enough power. That was why. So from the beginning, you look and you have the Articles of Confederation thrown out. Supposedly they did it legally. Not really. And they exploited a lot of people in the process, or kept people in the dark and things like that. So technically it wasn't an overthrow, and I'm not an expert on this. I'm not a historian. But from what I understand, you could say for all intensive purposes, it was as close as you can get to an overthrow of the government without overthrowing it. And when I say that, I mean they did overthrow it, but they followed the, you know, not overthrow it, but they implemented a new government. They rewrote the governing documents. So, but they did that right away. Why do you think they did that? I mean, what was it like? 4 years or something, 5 years with the Articles of Confederation. No one really thinks about that. So I think from the beginning, and I'm not saying all of them, and this is, of course, just my theory, that it was for the elite. That's why they wanted a stronger federal government. And at the time, all the elites were, you know, white within the U.S. Now, all the elites are not white. And you look at it, it's not just Americans controlling things in the U.S. neither. So it's not a, you know, they're probably, the majority are white. But not all the elites are white. But at the time, all the elites within the U.S. were. So from the beginning, I believe that that was their whole plan. But because they were so smart, it was to do it over generations. It was to do it in a way that it would be maintained instead of overthrown. Because if you come out, you look at Hitler, you look at Mao and all these dictators, although, you know, some of them never got overthrown, like Castro. He took over and was in power till he died. So it doesn't necessarily, I don't know if there were uprisings in Cuba or not, but they wanted to do it over generations and do it in a way that it would last. Because what they're doing, and you can see it with anything, you know, take guns, for example. And I was talking to somebody about this the other day. And, you know, I know some people, for whatever reason, want to go after certain guns and whatever. But the whole purpose of, I've talked about this, the reason why they want to go after semi-automatic rifles is because they're more efficient in defending yourself against the government. as opposed to handguns, which kill more people. But if you're looking at like guns, look at how in the Second Amendment, and people dispute this, but there are no restrictions. It doesn't say anything about background checks or registration or anything like that. It actually doesn't even say anything specifically about just guns. It says arms. And I think that that would be the only, I've mentioned this a bunch of times, that the only balance you'd have against the government would be if you had the arms that they had. Supposedly, Washington actually even said that. And at least to have the what the police have, which we don't. Now, we did at one point when they didn't have tanks and fucking automatic weapons. And even though you can get a permit to get some certain automatic weapons, but you got to go through a long background check. And I'm not sure what the standard is, if it's having any arrests at all or... But I know it's a higher standard than just getting a concealed carry permit, which is just no felonies and no, domestic violence and stuff like that. No, what do you call it? Restraining orders. But pretty much it's, they can't deny you unless you have one of those things. But if you look at that, if you look at drugs, if you look at all these things where they changed people's opinions, because people in the late 1900s or 1800s, early 1900s, before there were any gun regulations, and even when they started to be able to have the, you know, Tommy guns and things like that, they didn't think that way. Now, some people might have started to think that way. And then I think the first gun legislation was in the 30s. And this, and same with drugs. The first was in, 1917 or 1914? The Harris Act, which had to do with heroin. So before that, and that was about racism, because they said with heroin, it was the opium, and it was Chinese people are going to come here and get white women high off opium and take advantage of them. Some ridiculous fucking bullshit. So the point I'm making is that they've changed opinions. The average person now, even somebody who is really in the guns, a collector or just your average shooter, you know, person who has a bunch of guns and goes out shooting, believes in background checks, believes in the current laws. I don't think there should be any restrictions, but they do, and they defend them. So my point being is that through generations and propaganda and manipulating people, they were able to do things like that. And that's what they essentially, I believe, was the plan with everything, was over generations, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take more control over people's lives. But not only are we going to take more control over people's lives, we're going to get them to want to give us that control. They're going to be asking us for it. And look what happened. You even have people now that, I remember a quote of some guy, like, if I have to have rectal cavity search to protect against terrorists, then I'll do it. Even though if you look at the amount of people that are actually killed from terrorists in the U.S., it's usually zero. depends on what they define as a terrorist. But even when it's not, because there were those couple shootings that they defined as the terrorist acts, there's been, what, like four in 15 years, and the government wants to take credit, but then they want to say that, oh, somebody like the Tsarnaev brothers, who they were watching, they didn't know he went to another country because the name spelling. So they want to take credit, but then at the same time say they're incompetent, which is bullshit, because obviously they knew all about Tamerlan Tsarnaev, and he was, and with the research that I'd done, I believe that he was working for the CIA. I mean, the CIA had interviewed him and talked to him before, as had the FBI. And they claim they didn't know that he went on this trip because it was so idiotic to give that as a reason. That's the reason they came up with. But anyway, so to take total control over everyone, they need the police to do it, obviously. And they need people to support the police and to support the control. That's the whole thing that they want, and why it's generational. Because the taking control in a way where people are even asking you to do it and going along with it, just like, and I think there was a saying with this, that the government doesn't have to go after people that criticize it, because they have people that will do that on their own. Brainwash people that if you talk about, America, they'll get mad. They'll, you know, look at Colin Kaepernick not standing for the national anthem. And that's, I never stand for it for different reasons. Somewhat similar. I mean, police is one of them, but not for fucking Black Lives Matter. But we'll get to them a little later. But they want people to support the police and want to be policed and basically want to have their rights violated. It's like, it's crazy. It's Stockholm syndrome. You know, when you're kidnapped, and the definition of Stockholm syndrome is when you're kidnapped and you actually like fall in love with your kidnapper, or look at them as a friend or whatnot. But that's really what it is, or battered wife syndrome, you know, where the wife thinks they deserve it or whatever. So people, through government propaganda and brainwashing and government schools and government media and all of this stuff, are asking for the government to do a lot of the things they do. And we're going to get to a point where they say, yeah, get rid of all cash because we don't want terrorists doing this. Or, you know, pass this law that gives up another freedom, or pass this law. And that's what they keep doing. And a lot of people are supporting it. And that's the ultimate fucking way to take over a country, or to take over control over people's lives, is by having them ask for it. It's not even that they're doing it and people are outraged. It's they're doing it, and not everybody, obviously, but you have a lot of people that want it. And even with the little things, like I said, like drugs and guns and things like that, where they became accustomed to, oh, it's got to be like this. Like, you have to have background checks, or you have to have a drinking age, or you have to have, you, these drugs have to be illegal or regulated by prescription. That they've been convinced that all of that is needed, and that the government has to control that. That you as an adult, and everybody else as an adult, because there may be a tiny percentage of people that may abuse it, that it should be taken away, or it should be controlled by government. It's crazy. So that whole thing, and what they've done with the police, what I believe I've seen that's happened over the past few years, was all basically a almost rigged type of thing for a lot of people. I mean, there were genuine people involved in certain protests and stuff like that, but they brought things from people talking about, because before, if you go back to, like I was saying, before Black Lives Matter, before people, the government media even mentioned anybody getting killed by a cop, or, you know, rarely, or just locally. I mean, they'll mention like locally, but I mean, on a national level, you had people, conservatives like Alex Jones and people that follow him, talking about the police and taking too much power, militarizing, all of that. So you had people in general talking about issues with the police, that the police have too much power, that they're too militarized. They are power hungry. They, you know, all of these things. So you go to now, where a lot of people's views have changed. And as far as talking about it, I don't hear anybody talking about it anymore, really. I'm sure Radley Balco's out there, you know, doing his thing, who wrote, I can't think of the name of the book right now, Rise of the Warrior Cop, and definitely read that book. But, and you have Cop Block still, but I mean, they're a grassroots group that doesn't get funding. The reason you don't hear about them, and this is what, why I've said, if you hear about a group nationally, it means they're being funded by somebody. Because Cop Block is huge. At least they were. I don't know where they're at this point. And even the millions of likes they had on Facebook, and nobody really, they didn't get any national media attention. They were mentioned like once or twice to just put them down. I remember on O'Reilly once they mentioned Cop Block, and they didn't even mention the name of, because they talked about a Damo Freeman. They might have said that to make fun of his name, because that's not his real name. It's Adam, is it Adam Mueller or something? But they had basically just made fun of them and made a joke out of them or something. So, and then you had the whole thing in New Hampshire with the Free State Project on the Colbert Report and the Stephen Colbert. There's another guy that it almost sounds the same, that's on YouTube, that does a lot of good stuff, and you should check him out. But they, you never really heard about them on a national level. And that's why, because they don't have some other fucking, they don't have billionaires funding them, because that's not the agenda of the elite. They don't want fucking police brutality to be out there. They don't want a negative image of the police. They don't. Even though they funded Black Lives Matter, they did it in a way that really all it did was promote socialism in the end and progressive, the progressive agenda. So they were able to take a issue that I think a lot of people were starting to look at. And I'm not saying you still don't have people looking at it, but bring it down a notch, or a huge notch, to where it is now. And now it's just, when people talk about police, it's all about race. And you have the conservatives on the other side, you know, defending the police because they're saying it's not all about race. They're not talking about the police in general violating people's rights and freedoms and things like that. So I'm going to take a quick break and play some clips. I have a lot of clips, actually. I'm not even sure which ones I should play. But and when we come back, we'll get into the details of what I believe happened and how this is all part of the bigger agenda to ultimately take control of everything and everyone. So I'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan libertyforall.com.
And with me now, Milwaukee County Sheriff David Clark. Clark, what do you say? I mean, what's your reaction to this? Is it open season on law enforcement in this country?
Judge, I am too pissed off tonight to be diplomatic about what's going on, and I'm not going to stick my head in the sand about it. I said last December that war had been declared on the American police officer led by some high-profile people, one of them coming out of the White House, one coming out of the United States Department of Justice. And it's open season right now. There's no doubt about it. Look, anytime a law enforcement officer is killed, a little of every police officer in America dies along with them.
And Sheriff, you know, as law enforcement across the country watches this, and I asked the sheriff, Sheriff Hickman in Harris County, you know, in New York and in Baltimore and in Ferguson, you know, no peace, no justice, no peace, and all the crazy marches and all the, you know, some of these organizations out there. Apparently in Harris County, this isn't something that was normal. I mean, can this happen anywhere in the country now?
Anywhere in the United States, and I'm tired of hearing people call these black activists. They're not activists. This is black slime, and it needs to be eradicated from the American society.
But how
and American
do you do
culture.
It? How do you do it, Sheriff?
Well, here's how you do it. I need every law-abiding person in the United States of America to stand up and start pushing back against this slime, this filth, this disparaging the American law enforcement officer within these communities. When these ugly people come out and start this and start talking this stuff on social media, to push back against it and demand people that belong to these organizations to get out of their town. There's no room for it. Look, the American police officers holding these communities together, and we need the support of the people that we defend every day in order to get that done. God bless the Harris County Sheriff's Office. Kudos to that district attorney for acknowledging the war on police. But I'm tired of qualifying all these statements by talking about bad apples within the policing profession.
All right. Sheriff, I want you to take a listen to what Ron Hickman, the Harris County Sheriff, said.
We've heard black lives matter, all lives matter. Well, cops' lives matter too. So why don't we just drop the qualifier and just say lives matter and take that to the bank?
Interesting reaction.
We need to hear more of that from everybody. I know there's been some pushback on that, and that's good. This whole movement, Black Lies, I've renamed it L-I-E-S, because it's based on a lie, the hands up, don't shoot. That's why I said this slime needs to be eradicated from American society and American culture.
And with someone like this defendant, and this is, he's charged with murder, and it is death eligible, capital murder, the killing of a police officer. You know, we saw in New York City with Ramos and Wen Jian Lu, two cops sitting in a police car. I think it was Christmas Eve.
And obviously, cops' lives are more important in the eyes of the government because you get a harsher penalty for killing a cop than killing a regular person. So, to the government, blue lives or whatever the fuck they want to call them matter more than regular people. And obviously, it's been obvious in all of the killings by police when they always get off. I can't name anybody convicted. And I can only name one or two officers, because it was two in the same murder, beating that homeless guy to death. And if anybody should have went to jail, Jesus. And that's another one that people heard a little about it, but they could have gave that a lot of coverage, and they didn't. And it was obvious. You have a homeless guy that they just beat to death. How can you beat somebody to death that's not even fighting back? He never was fighting back. It's insane. And he was white. So, I don't know. We'll get back to talking about more of this after the clips. And this Sheriff David Clark is just a fucking douchebag. I can't stand him. He's the one who's a fucking piece of garbage.
Just get executed. You know, someone in New York City comes after a cop with a machete in his hands. And this is happening all over the country. I mean, what impact does this have on law enforcement? I mean, do they back off or do they just keep doing their job? Or are they like, you know what, I don't need this. We got six cops indicted in Baltimore. Why would someone even be a cop these days?
Well, we better hope that that doesn't happen for the sake of the rule of law, the sake of our way of life here in the United States. This was an assault on the American way of life, the American justice system. And if the American police officer backs off, we're all in trouble. Look, we live in a state of hypervigilance, and now we're going to have to turn that up even more. But the American police officer is strong. We will continue to fight back. We will continue to sacrifice ourselves for the good law-abiding people in every community of the United States.
And finally, Sheriff, the national rhetoric that's going on, you say that people need to push back and we need to see things when we see things on Facebook or on social media. You know, the truth is that people can say and do whatever they want. This is America. But without leadership, you know, there isn't going to be any different, you know, reaction. More people seem to be emboldened by this kind of thing.
Right, and that's why I said that the President of the United States started this war on police. Look, and I know what you mean, Judge, by that, but it's not absolute. You can't say anything you want in the United States of America. You cannot threaten people's lives. You can't call for the killing of people like we're seeing from some of these things. That is not First Amendment protection. That is protected. That is filth. That is slime. And, you know, there are some law enforcement implications that can be done with the Department of Justice and with state attorneys' offices across the United States. I love the First Amendment. I love freedom of speech. You are not free to threaten my life or anybody else's.
All right. Sheriff David Clark, thanks so much for being with us tonight.
My pleasure.
All right.
All of them should be held responsible because the police officers, the good ones, as they say, they don't testify against them. So they're all bad. If you're a part of that gang, you need to quit your job.
Wow, a slap in the face to law enforcement just days after an NYPD cop was killed in cold blood, who, by the way, was African-American. Hundreds descending upon the streets of Midtown Manhattan to march against cops and even chant expletives for those who protect and serve, and were protecting them on that day, too. Here now to discuss where we go from here, Fox News contributor and former homicide.
I hate fucking breaking into these things, but cops don't protect and serve. They show up after the fucking crime happens. Let's get that straight right now. They even took it off the fucking cars for a reason. Also, the Supreme Court ruled, for people that don't know, that cops have no duty to do anything. Meaning, if a cop's standing right there and somebody's attacking you, they have no legal obligation to do anything. So they don't serve and protect shit. That's why police, as far as I'm concerned, should not exist. Because the main, and we'll get to this later, but the main purpose is to protect and keep people safe. That's what people want. People just want to be able to live their lives and be safe and be protected, and that's it. Cops don't do that. They can't do it. Yeah, they can patrol, I guess, and maybe somebody won't do something if they see a cop car, but that's about it. Unless they violate people's rights, which they do, and get into pre-crime, which they're trying to get into, and trust me, they will get further into that in the future. Well, they're kind of doing it now to an extent with quote-unquote terrorists that the FBI fucking, you know, gives them everything, roots them on, and then, you know, locks them up for fucking 30 years and says that they were going to carry out a terrorist attack, which is just some nerd behind his computer that never would have done shit. But we'll go back to this.
Homicide Detective Rod Wheeler, who was out and got those sound bites for us and did all those interviews, and Milwaukee County Sheriff David Clark. Since we spoke to you, Rod, earlier, let's get the sheriff to weigh in. Sheriff, your reaction to some of the sentiment you heard on the streets on Saturday.
Well, it's just crazy talk. That's ignorance in its purest form. You know, I think we need to rethink this strategy. I don't know why the police even bother policing those.
Just a added note, if you didn't know, Sheriff David Clark is black, because we will get into race in this discussion, although it's not the main focus. The main focus is the police and why things kind of morphed into what they did, and really race is a one of the main reasons why, because it was made all about race instead of made about the police. Not to say that race is not a factor, because, well, we'll get into all that when we get back. I want to play some of these clips because I think they're important, but I just wanted to mention that about Sheriff David Clark. Douchebag David Clark. Well, I think he's, because he's on the news all the time, and that maybe he's looking for, you know, in the future, running for office beyond, because I don't know if they're elected in Milwaukee, but usually sheriffs are elected. So looking for the publicity that he gets so he can go and run for office in the future. And the only reason he gets the attention that he gets is because he's black and he says the shit that he says. Like Fox News wants to get a black sheriff on that will, you know, talk all this shit. So, and I never knew Milwaukee was, I thought of fucking Wisconsin, like there's, I didn't even know like they had a big black population. That sounds weird the way I said it, but I didn't mean it in any disrespectful way, but I didn't know that there was, in Milwaukee, I guess, there's a huge black population. And who would have thought? I had no idea. I thought Milwaukee was more of a white city, I guess. But I guess Milwaukee has a huge black population where they had, I think there were riots or protests. It might have just been protests recently. And he, he did something recently where he threatened somebody or something for asking him a question. Yeah, he was on a plane and he threatened some guy And it was really over. He was wearing a Dallas Cowboys shirt or something, and the other guy was wearing Green Bay, and he looked at him because he's from Milwaukee. So he's like, you know, and Dallas played Green Bay. So I guess he was looking at him like, hey, what the fuck, man? You're from Milwaukee. What you wearing the Dallas shirt for kind of look? And he like went nuts. So anyway, we'll get back to this.
Demonstrations, they're not protests. Those people advocate for the of our legally constituted government.
Hey, what I would do says they have
is let them fend for them. Let them fend for themselves. Let the good law-abiding people of New York clash with them for disrupting their lives, disrupting their businesses. Then the police can show up and arrest these subhuman creeps for creating a disturbance. That we can do.
Now, Rod, do you have a different sense? You're actually on the street talking to them. Number one, did the cops play an important role in keeping them safe? And tell me about the sentiment you heard.
They did, Brian. I mean, the cops were out there. You know, I must say that the police were taking a lot of verbal abuse while they were out there, and it was really unfortunate. But I also must say that the police did not turn their backs on the citizens. And even the people that had the biggest mouths out there, the folks that I was talking to, if they were to call those police officers today, those same police officers would still be there to assist them. Look, Brian, it was just last week when a young New York police officer was gunned down in cold blood right here in this city where I'm at now. And you know what? This officer hasn't even been eulogized yet, and these people are out there talking about death to cops. So I think it's ridiculous, and I wish that the politicians would speak up a little bit more, because actually, you know what I think? I think a lot of these protesters get their energy from some of these liberal politicians. That's just my opinion.
And Ryan Sheriff, I want to bring it to the president. I'll just paraphrase what he said. Essentially, he says these are people who are very angry, and they're standing up because this has been a wrong that has not been righted yet. Your reaction?
But you know what, though, Brian? A lot of the people I talked to, I'm sorry, Sheriff, a lot of the people that I talked to, they were saying that their frustration, believe it or not, is with the government, and they specifically said, Brian, President Obama.
Wow. Sheriff, go ahead.
Well, first of all, there is no police brutality in America. We ended that back in the 60s, so I don't know where they're coming from. You look at the data and the research, and there's a new Harvard study out that shows that there is no racism in the hearts of police officers. They go about their daily duty, if you will, to keep communities safe. The President of the United States knows better. He's playing the race game. He's playing race politics. Shame on him. He's been very divisive for this country. He has been a nightmare, and I cannot wait until January.
So just to add here, this is the conservative side, the other side that I'm talking about, because this whole thing wouldn't have worked as well if you didn't have them on one side and then Black Lives Matter, the progressives on the other side. And that's what I'm trying to show, is that you had them keeping it going, just like the Democrats and Republicans will take an issue and fight about it just for the, you know, it could be a bullshit issue just for distraction and division and all of that. And that's what a lot of this was. So that's part of it. Why I want to play some of these along with just the things that, you know, this is a fucking sheriff and the shit that he's saying.
January 2017, so that America's nightmare can be over.
Black Lives Matter, does it play an important role? First, you, Sheriff?
No, it's garbage. It's a subversive movement. Like I said, they advocate the overthrow of our legally constituted government. Right. It is not a protest movement.
Rod?
I think, yes, it does matter. I think all lives matter, and I think what they're arguing about and protesting about is valid. It's just the way that they're going about doing it, I think, is totally misdirected. Right?
It isn't valid. Knock it off. You're contributing to the problem here. It is not valid. There is no research.
But some of those people,
show me the data, show me the research
that
demonstrates or supports that lie that law enforcement officers use an inordinate amount of force against black people.
Yeah, but Sheriff,
black
you have
people
to
use
admit.
An inordinate amount of force against themselves and each other in the American ghetto. It is not true about the American police officer, and I'm not going to let anybody come on TV
and advocate that. You have to be fair, Sheriff, about all of this. Some of those people did have some valid arguments.
I don't have to be fair.
And
what
I'm not
I have to be is
at
factual.
All, and I would never suggest police officers are just go out and do things wrong to people, but there are some valid arguments that we both, on both
there
sides,
are
need
no
to really
valid
take.
Valid arguments. Right. There is no police brutality in the United all States.
Right. Sheriff Clark, Rod Wheeler, thanks so much.
Sure, thank you.
We're talking about this way too much. All I can tell you is you better show respect for people on the streets, whether they're state cops, local cops. They need to be respected, and I don't like where
fuck
it's trending.
You.
Thanks, guys.
You respect...
another day...
Show respect for cops because what? Really? They got a job with the government where they passed some test or whatever, and a lot of them, if their score was too high, they wouldn't hire them if they were too smart. So what rationale, why would you just respect them? It's like judges, too. Because they got enough votes, you should just automatically respect them. Where's the rationale as to why you should respect a police officer? Now, they would say, well, because they're going out there putting their lives on the line, even though, again, their job is not in most rankings in the top 15 most dangerous jobs. I looked up 2015. I think it was 41 cops were killed. I'm not sure for 2016. It might have went up, but it's a lot less than 100. I think it might have been around 60. And I'm talking about were killed by other people, not were killed by... They try to distort shit and talk about ones that were killed in car accidents and all of that. And you can't count that as, a cop being killed by somebody. A lot of them, it's their own fucking fault. Like some idiot Las Vegas cop died because he didn't turn his, this was years ago. He didn't turn his fucking lights on and then started, speeding down the road like he was going somewhere for an emergency.
Another Black Lives Matter shit show. Of all the problems that I think Black Lives Matter have both created and contributed to since they showed up a few years ago, and trust me, there are many, there's been one in particular that's been on my mind lately, and I'm seeing more and more of it, and it's what I view as a rise in Black supremacy. And listen, I'm aware that racial supremacy isn't anything new, no matter which direction it's coming from, but I've never seen it so blatant and unapologetic as I see it with some members of Black Lives Matter. For the first time in my life, I'm seeing things like this clip regularly.
You're not afraid to put people out! White people to the back! Black people to the front!
And for me, what happened in Milwaukee really solidified the existence of a subset of Black supremacy that has spawned from Black Lives Matter. It all began when an armed citizen, was shot by police after he attempted to flee from a traffic stop and raise his gun at an officer. Oh, and he was Black. So, cue the following.
Yeah, you can see what looks like a van on the left side of your screen that's burning.
And maybe even two vehicles.
Rocks and bricks being thrown at police officers, and then we had reports that there was a fire to a car, and when the firefighters came in, there were bricks thrown at them as well.
Remember stop and frisk? The unconstitutional practice of cops stopping and frisking someone only because they look suspicious? Now cops have upped the ante. Police across the country are stopping people who had not committed a crime and having them give up some of their spit for DNA collection. It's even scarier than stop and frisk because now cops are doing it to people they don't even suspect of sketchy activity. Now they're just doing it to random people to compile DNA samples, just to build DNA databases of everyone so that their tracking will be that much more complete. During nonviolent encounters with police, like when you get caught riding a bike without a helmet or going through a red light, people are being asked to turn over their DNA by letting the cops swab the inside of their mouth. Now, cops are supposed to ask for it. It's supposed to be voluntary. But more often than not, cops make it seem like it's mandatory, just the way they ask. So people just do it, especially teens who are already scared of getting in trouble. Their parents are nowhere to be found. They don't realize they have a choice. They don't even realize what it is. And they certainly don't even realize it's raising a big constitutional question. Under the Fourth Amendment, cops must have reasonable suspicion a person is doing something criminal before requiring a search or seizure. But since cops are asking people to give up their DNA voluntarily, they're getting around those pesky constitutional rights. And it's becoming so popular that business is booming for DNA collection companies. Now, cops can analyze a person's DNA right at the station in just 90 minutes at automated rapid DNA machines. Cops across the country agree DNA collection is the wave of the future. Bigger cities enter the DNA samples into the FBI's national database, where they're regulated. But smaller cities are partnering with private labs that offer faster, cheaper testing for a local database of citizens where there is zero oversight. It's the ultimate form of tracking, and it's becoming more and more popular. It is surveillance at a level that would blow even Orwell's mind. Makes you kind of long for the days when a cop would just pat you down for no reason and then let you go. With Stop and Spit, the cops will be watching you forever. Tonight, let's talk about that.
Well, Black Lives Matter is seeing green. The activist group now cashing in on tens of millions of dollars from liberal foundations and donors, despite inciting violence with chants like this.
That was like an old chant, and I believe in New York City like 2 years ago, and that's, they always refer to that one fucking chant that happened once. It's, I don't know.
That's right. The chant calling for the murder of police officers. Well, the Black Led Movement Fund is a donor campaign aimed at raising $100 million for the group. That's in addition to more than $33 million in grants from top Clinton donor George Soros, whose aim is to destabilize this country. So does this prove the group is just yet another arm of the Democratic Party? Here to weigh in is the editor and chief of the Politistic, Jennifer Burke. Jennifer, it's great to see you this morning. So
great to see you too, Tucker.
I'm not sure how many people have actually read the Black Lives Matter platform, which is not mainstream, to put it mildly. It calls for reparations for slavery, calls for voting for 16-year-olds. It calls for all kinds of things that are just way out of the mainstream of American life. I wonder if the donors have read this. Do you think they have?
I actually think they have. I mean, at least for the Ford Foundation.
The fucking donors put it together. That was the whole point. That if you look in there, you see climate change and 16-year-olds voting, actually, I have no problem with, even though voting doesn't do anything anyway. But climate change is in there. And there was a bunch of other shit that had nothing to do with anything police or Black Lives Matter. It was the progressive party, you know, the progressive Democrats' agenda is what it was, with, you know, mixed in with stuff to make it, you know, more Black Lives Matter like, but then they put all this other shit in there.
And they are, they're all about social justice. And, you know, when you have Cecile Richards on your board of trustees designating where money goes, which kind of grants go to which people, the woman who is in charge of Planned Parenthood, the largest killer of Black children in this country, it's really incredible, and it really makes you wonder what's their end goal, because it's quite hypocritical where their money goes in different places.
I guess what bothers me, I mean, I don't agree with their politics, that's fine, I don't agree with a lot of people's politics, but there is a strain of racial separatism that's really clear when you read their documents and watch their behavior that is bad for the country. I mean, have we given up on the idea of integration, do you think? It seems that way.
It does seem that way, doesn't it? When you have Black students in colleges calling for safe spaces, and you have Black and white students not going to class, saying that their activism or their classes are getting in the way of their activism, it's really mind-boggling. You know, you had a generation of people that fought for integration, and now you have a whole other generation of people that wants to self-segregate, and you have college universities that are complying with that, with separate housing, new special buildings. It's all quite disturbing, Tucker.
Well, they're arguing for separate but equal and for racial discrimination. I mean, it's Orwellian in its ironies. Here's a quote from the Black-Led Movement Fund. I'm quoting now. The Black-Led Movement Fund provides grants, movement, building resources to organizations working to advance the leadership and vision of young Black, queer, feminist, and immigrant leaders who are shaping and leading a national conversation about criminalization, policing, and race in America. They're not great writers, as you can tell. But what exactly does that mean?
What does it mean? I find it interesting. You know, you started out, Black Lives Matter started out as a movement in Ferguson, Missouri, based on the lie, Michael Brown never had his hands up, never said don't shoot. And I remember in Ferguson, people said there was a lot of out-of-towners, a lot of out-of-staters. And then now it's all of a sudden evolved from this demand for justice on the streets for black people to all of a sudden you have queer and I just don't even understand where it's going. It's highly organized. There's nothing grassroots about it, like with the Tea Party. And it's just systemic destruction of society. That's all I can think that it is based upon what they do.
And Hillary Clinton has full-throatedly endorsed Black Lives Matter. I think we're the only news organization in America who even notes that. It's bizarre. Jennifer Burke, it's great to have you on this morning. Thanks for doing this. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, nonpartisan liberty for all radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan liberty for all.com. Check us out at our website. Call in if you'd like, 702-470-7664, or you can reach us via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. All that information is on our website, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, as well as our email if you want to contact us that way. And there's also a chat room, which I can see. So if anybody goes in there and asks a question or anything like that or wants me to address something, I can do that as well. So that was really not all of it, but the David Clark shit was the conservative side because they needed to keep it going on both sides. So what you had was they needed to build up the anti-Black Lives Matter people and pro-police. Really, it was more important about them being pro-police than anti-Black Lives Matter. And I say that because, to me, that was the whole purpose. It was pushback or, what's the word I'm looking for? They got, like, getting fed up with the racial part of it and I think a lot of them already just defended the police, to be honest. But it was to all those people that thought maybe the police were militarizing too much and doing all this and that. For them to look at it as, oh, it's all bullshit. And look at this Black Lives Matter group. They're bullshit. And it's not about race. There's nothing wrong with the police. This is just a big bullshit story, and they needed the side to do that. So you had Fox News and other conservatives putting that story out there, and then there was a backlash, that was the word I was looking for, towards Black Lives Matter. What's fucked up is the backlash towards Black Lives Matter affected the view of the police. It made people more pro-police. All of everything that went on made people more pro-police, even people that may have been starting to question some of these things. Of course, there's people that it didn't affect at all, but I'm saying that was the goal, I believe, and I think it worked to an extent. Now, I don't know how many people it worked with, but anytime I see any argument about police, they always bring up race and Black Lives Matter now, always. You can't have a discussion about police, or you won't see a discussion about police on any type of government media, even any conservatives talk about police without talking about Black Lives Matter. Now, conservatives, some of them that I heard were just ridiculously like they should go out blowing police. I mean, they were that far. What's that guy that he's like a Sean Hannity imitator? He sounds just like him. He's on Patriot Channel on on Sirius XM. I can't think of his name, but I remember the shit that he was saying was ridiculous. And this was a while ago because I got rid of Sirius. And Sirius was the same way. For a fucking internet radio, or not internet, because it was on the internet. I was going to say it started getting blocked at work. But for a satellite radio station to have like 200 channels and none of them were freedom oriented or non-partisan, basically, you had progressive channels and the conservative channels. That was it. As far as when it came to politics, it was fucking nuts. And again, most people, the majority of people, even though they might be part of a party, are not Democrats or Republicans. I think the majority are independents. Now, that's what I see. But they want to fit. I have a theory about the creations of these parties. They're both created in a way that's contradictory to themselves, because neither one, you know, the Democrats, they want sort of, not really anymore, the progressives, but there's some social, like people say I'm socially liberal and fiscally conservative or something. They don't go together. There's not a party that's consistent. And if you believe in freedom, they both want to control you, because traditionally, and this is just a very loose interpretation of the parties, is that, you know, the Republicans, they quote unquote believe in freedom when it comes to the economy and things like that, but not social issues. They're totally anti-drug and things like that. And the Democrats, so they're anti-drug as well, for the most part, as that, and they're pro-police too. And they're both pro-police, although Republicans shouldn't be if they actually stuck to what they said. But they want to control you when it comes to social issues, and the Democrats want to control you when it comes to more financial and things like that. But they've got to the point where they would just want to control everything and make everybody equal. But yeah, so, I mean, they created parties to make people part of the system of control. It's just, how are you going to be controlled? And they're really pretty much the same. I was making an analogy or an example just between Bush and Obama, you know, talking about how it doesn't matter who the president is because they're controlled, they're a puppet. They've done, when it comes to the important things, when it comes to things that have to do with freedom and things like that, they did the same shit. There was no real difference. There wasn't a lot of difference in general. Obama deported more immigrants than any other president ever. So it's funny how, you know, nobody said any, all these people that don't believe in these policies, well, we like Obama though, because he's our guy, so we're not going to say anything. It's just there. It's another tactic that they use for people to fall in line. So anyway, things started, and I'm only going to use this as an example, because this is an example of how things went from, say, taking one issue and manipulating it and exploiting it to push an agenda that has nothing to do with the original issue. So Trayvon Martin, and based on watching the trial and the evidence I heard, I do believe that was a justifiable shooting based on Florida law, and it wasn't self-defense. Now, it was unfortunate. There were some things that shouldn't have happened, but they use that, and that's a perfect example of how the media, and this wasn't a cop, first of all, so that's where, you know, if it was a cop, I would have looked at it totally differently, because a cop should be able to handle that situation, and they work for the government, and they have a monopoly on force. So this was a private person. I don't like to use the word citizen because it doesn't mean anything. It's fucking meaningless. It means you got to pay $3,000 to expatriate, which means, you know, leave the country permanently or renounce your citizenship that you didn't ask for in the first place. So they presented it like he was kind of killed by a cop because he was a neighborhood watch person. They edited the tape so it looked like he was calling in to say a black guy. They originally, I think, even said he was white. And you look at the first pictures of George Zimmerman that they took with his head all, you know, bashed up and cut up and shit. And he looks like a fucking, you know, straight up Hispanic guy. You know, and he was in court and he got fat and shaved and whatever. Like, he had a goatee and he looked like, if I would have seen him on a street, I think he's 100% Hispanic. But I mean, he's Hispanic. But they changed the story. They would show pictures of Trayvon Martin at 13. My fiance thought that this guy killed a 13-year-old. And obviously, if that was the case, then it would be totally different. But she thought, like, oh yeah, that guy killed like a little 13-year-old. No, he killed a 6'2" or whatever, 180-pound fucking guy who started hitting him. And supposedly he was walking back to his car. So if you're getting beaten by somebody, and that's where I differ between, you know, you hold cops to a higher standard. If you're getting beaten by somebody, you know, I believe you have the right to defend yourself and use lethal force if necessary. Now, it's unfortunate that that happened. And then, you know, all this, the whole thing is it's all about race. He was a racist, even though he's Hispanic. They're calling him white and all of this shit. And he actually, in those pictures, even kind of looked like a thug, man. If you want to talk about, oh, who, you know, who looks like a thug, I'm talking about George Zimmerman. So, and I'm not a George Zimmerman fan or supporter or anything. I'm looking at this objectively. And in the end, what happened? Well, what happened was it turned into a protest about changing a self-defense law, the stand your ground law, and becoming to promote gun bans or going after guns. And then with another guy who obviously, you know, murdered this kid and who was white, they used that to, for the same reason, they went after that same law. And he neither used the law to try to defend themselves. And the other incident, it was at a gas station. That guy had no defense. He fucking just murdered a fucking kid. I mean, he made up like, well, I thought he had a gun or some bullshit, but that guy, you know, he got like 60 years. And he didn't get convicted of first degree. I think they charged him with first degree murder of the kid that actually got killed, but he got charged with all these other charges because of the other kids in the car. But the reason people didn't even think of this, the reason he didn't get convicted of first degree murder, because obviously it wasn't first degree murder, or even second degree murder, because it wasn't first degree murder is fucking, and I'm not talking about George Zimmerman, but the same thing applies to him too. But obviously it's not first degree murder because it wasn't premeditated and planned. If something happens on the spot like that, it's manslaughter. And they might have charged him with, I thought they charged the other guy with first degree murder. And that's why I think he was not guilty of that and they didn't give an option. And the same with George Zimmerman, where he might have even got convicted under the pressure of manslaughter if that was an option. But the DA said, no, second degree murder, which, regardless of what you think, that wasn't second degree murder. If it's anything, it would have been manslaughter. Or maybe even involuntary manslaughter, to be honest. No, actually, I think manslaughter is just no intent. I have to go and look back at the definitions, because first degree is premeditated, second degree is intent, but not premeditated, and then I believe manslaughter is there's an action that happens that results in that person's death, but it wasn't premeditated, and it wasn't, there was no intent to actually kill them. They just ended up dead as a result of your actions. So you can't say that George Zimmerman, it was premeditated murder, and you can't say it was second degree murder neither, that there was an intent to kill him. There was an intent to stop him from, beating him. And I don't know. I mean, you know, Trayvon Martin could have been a tough kid. I mean, then you hear the other side of it, and, you know, I wouldn't, they called him a thug and the gang. Well, they said he had tools and he was breaking into places and stuff like that. And I don't know that that's true, that he smoked weed and he was drinking purple drink. And to me, that's shit that fucking high school kids do. Not the breaking in, but the, you know, smoking weed and fucking drinking. Even the purple drink with codeine, whatever. I don't look at that as that makes him a bad kid. From what I heard, I mean, I would call him kind of like a punk kid. I watched basically the whole trial, but I wouldn't call him a thug. But I think they were saying that he was selling drugs in school and shit too, but I still, you know, I wouldn't call him a thug. And it's an unfortunate incident, but looking at it based on the evidence, I don't believe that Zimmerman was guilty of, definitely not of second degree murder. No way. Now, if you want a lesser crimes in another state, yes, but not in Florida based on the laws. So anyway, it turned from it being a racial thing, even though then you hear all the stuff about Zimmerman, how he, I think he tutored black kids or something. I don't know. There was some, all the stuff like positive stuff like that. Plus, again, he's Hispanic. He's not white. And the other thing was there were places getting robbed in that area, and they had identified the person that was robbing them as black as well. But he, I don't know. The whole thing was a media creation. We should have never heard about it because it shouldn't have went further than Florida. But it became a national fucking thing. And it was distorted initially and throughout most of it by the media on both sides. So, and then it turns into, you know, get rid of this self-defense law, which they turned into, it's a racist law, even though black people can defend themselves as well. And the statistics, according to Sean Hannity, was that actually more black people have used stand your ground, even though George Zimmerman didn't use that as a defense. But more black people have actually gotten off because of stand your ground than white people. It's just ridiculous. And black people are entitled to get guns as well. And that's the whole thing with this. And I should go back a little to my history, but I believe in liberty for all. And that's the whole fucking how I even came up with the name of the show. I mean, initially I put in the nonpartisan because when you say liberty, it's a word that's used, that's been bastardized by fucking Republicans. So I wanted to make sure, hey, I'm not one of you motherfuckers. And really, I don't believe in government, period. So that's kind of how I came up with the name. I want freedom for all people. It doesn't matter what race. I mean, if Trayvon Martin was white and the other guy was black or whatever races the people were, I want people to be able to fucking defend themselves. And that's bottom line. And yeah, I thought it was very unfortunate, and it wasn't something that was good that it happened or anything, but it was totally manipulated, and you have the president fucking talking about it, you know? And the facts were totally distorted. But about me, I mean, I've talked about this in high school. You know, I was at a school that it was majority white. At lunch, there was one table that was, you know, almost all the black kids sat at one table, and that's the table that I sat at. I hung around all the black kids in my last couple years of high school, just because before that they wouldn't be friends with me. But I've seen racism on both sides. I mean, I've talked about this. I had people at school calling me a wannabe nigga or white nigga, or you know, all that shit. And I went places where, you know, there were, because this is the Boston area, white people that like, we don't like white niggas around here. I mean, I've gotten all of that shit. And then I had black people that didn't like me because, you know, they're like, oh, you're trying to be like us or whatever. But that was very few. It was only one or two that actually came out and said it or acted like it, that caused, you know, that started fights with me over it. But throughout life, you know, I've been jumped, Jesus, three or four times by three or four groups of black kids. So, well, one time it was jumping, even though long story, the girl I was with or dating at the time was black, and I think they had an issue with that, and they totally disrespected me, and then I could have avoided it, but whatever. There were four or five kids, not kids, but you know, I call them kids because fucking they were younger than me. But so I've seen both sides of it. It's not the same, exactly the same thing. But, I mean, in high school and after it, I used to fight for or fight against racism, fight for black people's rights, I guess. I wouldn't say their rights, but because it's not like they didn't have rights. It was, you know, white people that fucked with them or whatever. I saw that, and you know, I would always defend the black people because I saw the racism from white people. But I mean, that was like 20 years ago. So I think that things have improved, and you know, the racism I saw, even still, because most of the white kids were scared of the black kids. That's why, too, later, and this is not why I was friends with them, but later, when I hung around with all my friends were black pretty much, they didn't bother me anymore because they were scared of all the black kids. It's kind of funny. And a lot of them weren't people that could fight or were into fighting or, you know, anything like that, or had access to guns. I mean, they weren't thugs. There's a couple of them were, but a lot of them weren't. One of my friends was just big and he could fight, but he wasn't into, you know, and he smoked a lot of weed, but he wasn't like a thug or anything like that. Well, a couple of my friends that I hung out with, that we'd all hang out together, they were both pretty big and, you know, would just smoke weed, whatever. But I saw all that shit, but it wasn't like racism even from the 60s. And they wouldn't really, most of the time, they wouldn't say it to their face. They'd say it to me before, and that was really before I started hanging out with them. And that was at the school I went to. But when I went other places, that's when, you know, if I wasn't with, because this was before. So before I started hanging out with them and I went other places, that's where, like, I had the time when some white kids, and of course there was one, and then he waited till his friends came, were like, well, we don't like white niggas around here, or whatever the fuck he said. I got sucker punched by some guy because of that, you know, all of this shit that had happened. So I've experienced that. Violence because of that. So there, you know, I've seen a level of racism, although, you know, and I got followed around in stores and all that shit and discriminated against in jobs, and, you know, I used to have braids in my hair and all of that stuff. So, and I had to work hard to get where I'm at anyway. You know, I didn't come from any privileged family with money or anything like that. And so I've talked about that before, but just so people have perspective, when I look at these things, you know, I don't look and sit and think of myself as, I don't identify with white people or other white people. I don't identify with any race, to be honest. And I'm half Jewish as well. But I'm just, you know, me. But I have a unique perspective that most people don't have. And at the same time, I'm not going to just say things because I'm scared of what people will think, or I'm just going to be on a certain side all the time and say whatever, you know, because the majority of black people say this, I'm on that side. No. And I don't, you know, now I don't really, well, I don't really hang around with many people, period. But I just look at people for people, and I would hang out with anybody as long as they respect me and I can trust them. Trust is a big thing. But I look at things for how I see them. I'm not going to take a side based on race, ever. So anyway, I just want people to understand that and realize that my, you know, I think a perspective, not just because of that, because of other things too. And I've had a lot of interaction with the police, unfortunately. And the first time this was my first interaction with the police, because my father called the police all the time. For like one time he punched, I talked about this, he punched me in the head and then called the police. Now, if that would have happened today, they probably would have arrested him. But this was a long time ago, And, you know, they asked me if I was okay, and I'm like, yeah. So I was 12, and, you know, I think he was so frustrated that he's like, well, if I don't call the police, I'm going to fucking kill him. And it was over something stupid. So, but the first time I got harassed by police was at 14 for, I lived in apartments, and we always lived in apartments until I was 21. And then we lived in a duplex that we rented. And this is Boston area. So it's like a shitty duplex. Well, it wasn't that bad, but, and I only lived there a couple of years, and then I moved into my own apartment, and then I lived in an apartment till I bought a townhouse that I earned totally on my own. And now we rent a house, me and my fiance, who's 100% of Mexican descent. So, but, and I've dated black girls, fucking Native American girls, Filipinos, I think other Asians. one of my ex-girlfriends is half Iraqi. So just to get some perspective, I have a totally different perspective than most people because of that and other things too. There's a lot of reasons why, and the things I went through growing up and in my life. So anyway, this isn't about me, but I meant to mention that at the beginning. So anyway, when I look at this, I see two things. So you have the Trayvon Martin thing, which was, I think, totally manipulated and blown out of proportion, but I'm using that as a example of how the issue was about race. It was about a black kid getting killed initially. Then it turned into what? The agenda, an anti-gun and anti-self-defense agenda. That is how they exploited it. And they had, I believe, a plan from the beginning. As soon as it happened, they were going to make it about race. They were going to fucking manipulate it the way they wanted it and fit it into this little narrative. And that's what they did. And then they used it to push their underlying agenda. That's what government does, and government media is a tool within that, as is government schools. Government media you can avoid, government schools you can't. But government media is more than just TV. It's everything. It's billboards, it's fucking newspapers, it's, you know, all of these internet, all of these things, pop-ups, commercials. Commercials, I think, are one of the most dangerous fucking things. Because if you look at commercials, it's a perfect example of propaganda manipulation. I'll see these commercials with a family, and it's like an emotional commercial, but it will be for a fucking car. And see what they're trying to do? And that's what the government does, in a sense, is they use that propaganda to pull people in. So how this really started, if you look at it, was the main thing was Michael Brown. And that's the story they focused on. And I believe that was totally calculated. And the reason why is because there were so many other people that were getting murdered by police over years and years, and nationally it was never focused on. So I think because of Trayvon Martin, it was kind of off the, you know, because they've talked about Trayvon Martin for a while off of that, they were able to lead into Michael Brown. And with Michael Brown, it was an example of a police killing that could go either way, that you could convince people. So the conservatives got people to take the cop side, and then they tried to get progressives to take the Michael Brown side. And it basically, you had all of these people saying different things as to what happened, what should you believe. So it wasn't a clear-cut story. And that's the one that the media focused on more than any other police killing. When you had so many blatant murders by police, you had the guy, I can't think of his name, who was beat to death by the police. You had a guy in New Mexico, that the homeless guy that they have on video, shot to death by the police. And they say, well, he had a knife. Yeah, well, you can't really see it. And if he did, they were like fucking 10, 15 feet away. And there were like four of them. And that happened, I think, before Michael Brown. So they did national coverage on Trayvon Martin, basically creating that narrative. Now they have Michael Brown. Now they have a story that they can put race into it, and they can divide people. And that's what they did. And I did a whole show on that. So if you go to Spreaker or a lot of the other applications, that should be there. But what they did from that is Black Lives Matter kind of came out of that. And initially, it was more about, you know, it was, yes, race-based, but that wasn't the focus of a lot of the people that were protesting and people online and people that were part of independent media. And then when government media kind of manipulated that whole story, you have Black Lives Matter came out of that. You have people that backlash that I'm talking about. And you had the division. And then you had the police, of course, claiming, and they were doing this before this, like when the cops in Las Vegas got killed, the police were saying there's war on the police, and anybody who criticizes police is it's just bullshit. Like, the police don't do anything wrong. It's insane. So you also had around the same time Eric Garner. Now, Eric Garner got a lot less coverage because that was an unarmed man who got choked to death by the police over fucking selling cigarettes. So that got more downplayed, although they tried to say, you know, same thing, but that, well, he deserved it because he did what he did, or he didn't obey the police, or, you know, it doesn't matter if they violate your rights, you should obey them. But that kind of came, they covered Michael Brown so much more. And essentially tried to manipulate, I think, people's opinions on any black person getting killed by police because of Michael Brown and then Black Lives Matter and all of that. So I believe you had a lot of people, because I even know some people that went down there, that genuinely were there to protest the police, have nothing to do with the socialist agenda, the real agenda of Black Lives Matter. And just wanted to protest what was going on. But then you have the people behind it and the people at the top, obviously, the leaders of it, and then the people behind it that are funding it. So I'm going to take a quick break before I choke on this French fry. I think I have a French fry caught in my throat, but we'll be right back after this. I have a couple clips that we can play. And then when we come back, I'll get more into Black Lives Matter, get into the other side, and then how this whole thing really developed into a pro-cop or not just pro-cop, but just not a non-issue. Because I see it now as, for most people, it's a non-issue. And it's a huge issue. And they're going to be the ones. It's very important to the takeover of everything and the government control. Because who are the enforcers? Well, the police are. So, and they want people to love their masters. They want people to, you know, love the people that are oppressing them. And it's really the politicians, but it's the police via the politicians. So I always said, don't forget about the politicians, the district attorneys, and the judges. They're just as culpable as the cop that's pulling the trigger. Even though so is the cop, because he's doing it as well. So we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Times. I mentioned this yesterday, and in fact, yesterday I said I was going to do it in one of the later hours, and it just got the show got away from me, and so I want to talk about it right now. Yamiche Alcindor, and I wonder if Yamiche, I don't know if this is a man or woman's name. I wonder if he or she, presumably she, is related to Lou Alcindor, who I thought had changed his name. I don't, you know, I'm so disconnected from sports that I, you know, in any case, I was wondering if that might be the child of that person. But here, the headline of the article is Black Lives Matter Coalition Makes Demands as Campaign Heats Up. And more than 60 organizations associated with the Black Lives Matter movement have raised at least a series of demands on Monday, including for reparations. And there are these six platform demands. More than 60 groups. I mean, this is not just, you know, some, you know, lone voice in the wilderness or somebody who's upset about, you know, the cops shooting somebody in their town last week. This is 60 national organizations associated with Black Lives Matter saying, here are our demands. We want to make America whole again. We want to make America whole. Black people have never had a whole, you know, an America where they were fully participants in it. And we want to make America safe for people of color. And by the way, all that slave labor that we provided you all with for hundreds of years, and all that slave labor and all that cheap labor that we gave to the economy and to largely white people, we'd like to be paid back for some of that, or at least our ancestors gave. Well, and we're still giving, or they are still giving. I shouldn't speak in the first person when I'm speaking of, you know, to be respectful, I shouldn't speak in the first person, I think. So anyhow, as part of the effort, this is what the Yamiche Alcindor wrote in yesterday's New York Times. As part of the effort, the groups are demanding, among other things, reparation for what they say are past and continuing harms to African Americans. an end to the death penalty, legislation to acknowledge the effects of slavery. I mean, we have now acknowledged, for example, something that we didn't acknowledge after World War II or even after Vietnam, that just going to war produces post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. I am increasingly convinced that it's very hard to grow up black in this country and not experience some level, even a small level of PTSD as a result of it. I hear story after story from friends of mine and from people who call into this program that when I put myself in their position, if I think, you know, if that had happened to me, I would be so wounded. I mean, I am, there's a part of, when I was 8 years old, there was a kid up the street by the name of Dennis who had, he had three or four friends, and they were like the neighborhood tough guys. And literally his house was right in a straight line between my house and our elementary school. And every time I walked by his house, he and his buddies would come out and they would just beat the crap out of me. Or just chase me down the street, you know, if I ran away, which I usually did. And I, to this day, I remember that. To this day, I feel wounded by that. Imagine, you know, for the white people watching or listening, just imagine. If tomorrow morning you woke up, got out of bed, went into the bathroom, looked in the mirror, and suddenly discovered that you were wearing the skin of an African American, how might your life change? What would your experience of walking down the street be like? Just walking down the street. What would your experience of looking for a job be like? Just think about that for a minute. Think of, you know, white people. Think of all the times you've applied for jobs and never, ever wondered, are they going to turn me down because of the color of my skin? Think of all the times you've walked into a restaurant or a store and never thought to yourself, am I going to be dissed because of the color of my skin? Am I going to be followed around and surveilled because of the color of my skin? White people, imagine this. Think about this for a minute. Seriously. We have done this. White people have done this to people of color in this country for 500 years. And far worse. So reparations for what they say are past and continuing harms to African Americans, an end to the death penalty, legislation to acknowledge the effects of slavery. And I would argue that what we're seeing today are still the lingering, you know, echoes of that, particularly in the South. But it's, you know, racism is not regional. There's as much vicious racism in the North as there is in the South. It just uses a different language. But the effect is the same. As well as investments in education initiatives, mental health services, and job programs. This all seems to me like pretty clean, straightforward stuff. When these statistics, I realize, are a couple of years old, I'm not sure what the exact numbers are today, but the last time I looked, the average white family in America had a net worth of around $80,000. And I don't know if that includes all the white billionaires or not. I'm guessing it doesn't, because I think that this was middle-class white families. But the average white family in America has a net worth of around $80,000. The average black family in the United States has a net worth of around $5,000. And my recollection is that after the crash in 2007, the average black family in America's net worth became negative, and the average white family's net worth in the United States dropped substantially. I think it dropped to around between $40,000 and $60,000. So why is it unreasonable to say, okay, let's just do something about that right now? This is essentially what LBJ's Great Society, or at least a large part of it, was about. And it wasn't just racially targeted. I mean, Lyndon Johnson was looking at poor white people in Appalachia and Mississippi as well as he was looking at black people. But what if we said, you who have been the victims of this, we're going to bring you up to parity for a generation. And you can raise your kids in quote, middle-class society with good job opportunities and good education opportunities and you know, a safe income. You know, frankly, we could do this for the entire country tomorrow morning with a national guaranteed income. That's a whole nother rant, I suppose. But that would be, you know, that might be one solution. But what, how do you compensate people for 500 years of damage that continues to this day? How do you do that? I don't have an instant answer, but I know that we need to be.
If you work in law enforcement, I have a very important question for you, one which soon may be a matter of life or death. I'm sure some people become police officers just so they can boss other people around. But I'm going to assume here that you mean well, that you want to be one of the good guys. In which case, my question is this. Is there anything the politicians could enact into law that you wouldn't enforce? Is there any order that you would refuse to carry out? Or will you do absolutely anything your bosses tell you to? In the U.S., police have already obeyed orders to fine or arrest people for a wide variety of harmless activities, such as dancing at the Jefferson Memorial or having a vegetable garden in their front yard. Police have even gone so far as to execute violent paramilitary raids on food co-ops and organic farms. For decades, police have been carrying out armed home invasions, forced property confiscations, and other acts of violence against people who weren't hurting anyone, but who engaged in behaviors or habits which lawmakers have arbitrarily declared to be illegal. You may be comfortable in assuming that you'll never receive an order to do something truly immoral, but the fact is, with every order you receive, you have a choice between obeying without question or relying on your conscience. No doubt there were cops a few years ago who never expected to be ordered to disarm innocent people, to do door-to-door home searches without warrant or probable cause, or to detain and interrogate people for merely driving down a road. Yet police have since been ordered to do all of these things, and almost without exception they obeyed. So it's not unreasonable to ask, is there any point at which you will draw a line and say, no, that I will not do? And if you won't draw such a line anywhere, if you will do absolutely anything your political masters tell you to, how are you any different from the enforcers of Soviet Russia, Red China, or Nazi Germany? You may be tempted to say, I don't make the law, I just enforce it. Or to argue that if some legislature, court, or some authority above you says it's okay, then it must be. But keep in mind that this is exactly what the thugs of every tyrannical regime in history said to justify their actions. And how do we remember those people now? As courageous, noble law enforcers? No. Unless you want posterity remembering you as a heartless, mindless pawn of oppression, then you'd better decide, and decide now, where you will draw that line. Unfortunately, there's little indication that most cops have any line at all. The incidents of police officers refusing to inflict injustice upon the people are extremely rare. Even when cops say they personally oppose certain laws, such as marijuana prohibition, nearly all of them continue to violently enforce these laws against nonviolent people. In other words, they recognize these laws as counterproductive and unjust, but they choose to enforce them anyway. For the most part, American cops seem completely incapable of disobeying immoral orders, and instead do what the enforcers of every other authoritarian empire have done, inflicting harm on innocent people whenever and however those in power tell them to, while accepting no personal responsibility for their actions. I hope you are better than that. Keep in mind, there are a lot of decent Americans who do have the integrity and courage to draw a line in the sand, a point at which they will disobey and resist violations of their rights by those in power. It may be that they refuse to be disarmed. It may be that they refuse to cooperate with warrantless searches, or refuse to keep funding a government they view as destructive and unjust. Whether you agree with them doesn't particularly matter. What does matter is whether in the end you are willing, if and when you are ordered to do so, to violently assault the dissenters for their disobedience. When they draw their line in the sand and stand their ground and your supervisors tell you to use whatever level of violence necessary to get submission and compliance from the resistors, will you obey? If it came down to it, would you kill American citizens for disobeying politicians? Now, if someone is actually harming someone else, of course you have the right to use whatever force necessary to stop the attacker and protect the innocent. But that would be the case even if you had no badge and no uniform. But when you try to arrest someone who hasn't threatened or harmed anyone else, but has only disobeyed some arbitrary regulation, then you are the one initiating force. You are the one starting a fight. You are the bad guy. Now remember, the American Revolution was people forcibly resisting gun confiscation, warrantless searches, what they viewed as unfair taxation, and a number of other oppressions. All in the name of law, all carried out by law enforcers. If you had lived back then, would you have been among the rebel colonists, the ones who refused to be disarmed, refused to pay taxes, and resisted warrantless detainment and searches? Would you have sided with the signers of the Declaration of Independence, or would you have been among the redcoats, the law enforcers, assaulting, caging, or killing any colonists with the gall to disobey the king? And which side are you on today? Of course, the message you'll get from your superiors, the politicians, and your fellow officers is that it's not your place to decide which laws to enforce, and that as long as you faithfully follow orders, that you can't be held personally responsible for doing as you're told. But that is a lie, a horribly dangerous lie. At the Nuremberg trials, it was established that the excuse used by the Nazi law enforcers that they weren't to blame and shouldn't be punished because they were just doing as they were told did not relieve them of personal responsibility for their actions. And make no mistake, if you choose to blindly obey unjust commands, and one day your intended victims decide to fight back, saying that you're just doing your job will not make you bulletproof. It may be your own life you save by deciding now at what point you will choose to be a moral, responsible human being instead of just an obedient pawn of those in power. Ultimately, only you can answer the question of where you will draw that line. But really, the only moral, rational answer is this. If something would be wrong for you to do without a badge, then you shouldn't do it with one either. The idea that uniforms and legislation can give you special rights is both false and horribly dangerous. Nearly every large-scale injustice in history was committed by people who wrongly imagined that their position of authority made it okay for them to do things that other people have no right to do. Like everyone else, you have the right to use force to stop attackers and protect the innocent, and when you do that, you are the hero. But you have no right to be the attacker, even if it's your job, and even if the aggression is called law. Always, in every situation, you and you alone are responsible for what you do. Wearing a badge and a uniform and doing whatever you're told does not make you brave and noble or deserving of any respect. Just following orders is a coward's excuse. If your job requires you to assault or cage people who haven't threatened or harmed anyone, then quit. Being an actual protector, doing the right thing no matter what anyone else says, even if it means disobeying orders and breaking the law, that takes courage and integrity. That makes you a hero. So, do you have enough of a spine to draw that line? Decide now, before your failure to think for yourself results in damage that cannot be undone.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. I just wanted to go through some of this quickly, just so I can get in all the information that I wanted to go over. But after Michael Brown, there were, I think in total, and I haven't really went and counted this, but there were less than 10 in 2 years that government media actually covered. And besides, and why is his name slipping my mind right now, besides the little kid that they murdered, they were all ones killings in which they could argue, although I disagree, I think the police were wrong in every single one of them, but they presented them in a way that the other side could argue, well, this is why he got killed, because, you know, someone had a gun in their pocket or things like that. Again, where throughout that time period, there were plenty of other fucking murders by police that were just blatantly, there was no argument. Although, even with the kid that they killed, people actually defended that. I don't think a lot, but you still had, of course, police did, because police can do nothing wrong in their fucking warped minds. But my point being is that instead of trying to focus on police shootings that were pretty blatant, they covered, and there's like three or four every day. They covered ones that there was always an argument on the other side. Now, you could say there is always an argument on the other side, but I mean, there was always an argument that would convince anyone that supports the police. And as more and more were covered like that, along with Black Lives Matter and highlighting all the negative shit that Black Lives Matter said, not any of the people that were just protesting, not any of the people that just said, talked about the police and having too much power. And I'm sure there's a lot of people that said, hey, it's about the police. They made it all about race. 100% about race. They didn't cover any white people or Hispanic people that were killed by the police. They didn't focus on the issue of the police. They focused on race as an issue. And that was it. And then on the other side, they focused on why race isn't an issue. Now, I will say that I believe a lot of police discriminate and automatically assume, not all police, but a lot of police assume all black people are criminals, or if they're dressed a certain way, they're criminals. So, yeah, and I do believe that the justice system is harsher on black people in general. And again, in general, that doesn't mean that every single person and whatever when it comes to sentencing. But a lot of the time, first of all, if you can't afford a lawyer, you get their court-appointed lawyer who's all in on it, and they make some fucked-up deal. And, you know, basically the majority of people are getting screwed over. I think that in the past, it was more blatant and there was a bigger difference. I think now it still exists, but I don't think there's as much of a gap as there used to be. But yeah, I mean, obviously, the government is the most racist organization that there is. That's why I don't get why. Well, I get it, because it's not about, it's obviously not about, you know, helping black people. It's about the progressive agenda. But why would you want more government when government has been the most oppressive throughout history? The most oppressive towards black people throughout history. So then comes in the demands, which you could tell, like I said, I mean, climate change was in there, LGBT community was in there. I mean, all of these things that have nothing to do with the police, that have nothing specifically to do with black people, were in there. There was a whole bunch of shit. I don't remember all of it. But then that comes out. And then you have the other side totally, of course, attacking that. And I even attacked that because it showed it for what it was. It was a front for to promote socialism. So then from there, they had at that point basically destroyed the issue of police and reforming police, which I don't believe in reforming them. I think you should just totally get rid of them. And that had already, I think, been an issue that by just focusing on race and the media and how they focused and who they focused on, they totally destroyed it. Then you have that come along, and now they're able to promote socialism and make it into a whole nother movement, which is what they wanted to do from the beginning, I believe. Now, not the people that are just protesting that actually have issues with the police and what they do, but the people behind it, the political operatives and the people that are, you know, the so-called leaders of Black Lives Matter. So you have that happen. And then they accomplished a couple things in this. One, they got to push the socialist agenda again. And that's what the money was going into. This had nothing to do with police. It had nothing to do with police even profiling, you know, killing Black people. And again, do I believe the police are racist? I believe it's a racist organization in general. I don't think that they necessarily hate Black people, but I think they do discriminate and look at Black people as criminals a lot of the time. So, but at the same time, they're violating the rights of all races, they're killing all races, and they're taking more power and control because more laws are being passed, more, you know, police are being militarized, and more terrorist law enforcement is being developed, and or anti-terrorist law enforcement like fusion centers and all of this shit that's going on. So now it's just race when the conversation of police comes up. It's about police killing Black people. It's not about police violating people's rights, police needing to be abolished as far as I'm concerned, because they don't protect or serve anybody or keep anybody safe. And the issue of them doing that to all people and then dividing people at the same time. And then you have the people on the other side and the backlash and the, you know, the support for the police that it developed at this, while this was going on, it developed this support of the police even more, and saying that, you know, oh, you should obey the police and it's your fault if you don't and all of this shit. And so they accomplished that. And then at the same time, they got a platform for their socialist agenda. And I'm saying they, the government. So they were able to get it out that way. And they're doing the same thing now with the women's march that they had against Trump and other marches that they had against Trump that were publicized. I talked about the one on C-SPAN. Obviously, it was funded by somebody. And I'm not a Trump fan. I can't stand them. But the point is that they're pushing this agenda. And Trump is going to go along with, I mean, he's already doing things or in the process of doing things that have to do with that are anti-freedom. And that includes supporting the police, and he'll, you know, make sure they're still militarized and probably even give them more shit in the name of quote-unquote fighting terrorism. And then now, because you had, what, two people that killed a couple cops, two or three in the past couple years that actually targeted cops, which again, the amount of cops that gets killed is tiny anyway. But they want to turn this into, oh, well, you know, cops are in danger. They need to be more protected and we need to give them tanks and whatever. Whatever they need to say to justify. So they accomplished a whole bunch of things. But the most important, I think, was that the focus is off the police. It's like, the police, you know, unless it's the only focus on the police is, oh, they're racist. But then you have this whole other group that talks about the police and how great they are and that they're not racist. But there's no talk about what about the police in general, the power they have, the rights they violate, the all of these things. No, that conversation's over. And then again, at the same time, now you got the socialist agenda being pushed out by not just Black Lives Matter, but other groups, because that's kind of where they want to go. Except, of course, the elite would be on top, you know, collecting all the money. That wouldn't apply to them. So it's all part, to me, in my opinion, it's all part of the plan to control people and to take away more freedom, because you need the police in that scenario. You need people to support the police and not criticize them and not talk about how they're militarized and all of this shit. So the media really, along with the government, helped to destroy that and really just create a racial divide that wasn't there. Now, I'm not saying that racism doesn't exist and that everybody gets along, because that's not the case. But they helped create this whole division. Now it's women, minorities, immigrants, whoever they can fit into this other bucket and create division. Because when people are fighting with each other, they're not talking about the police or the government or any of these things. It's the, you know, they're focusing on this over here. They're focusing on race instead of focusing on government spying or government taking away more rights or passing more laws that take away more of your freedoms. So that's essentially what they did. And at what point it just kind of, you know, I don't know that that was from the beginning, okay, this is how we're going to play this whole thing out, or as it evolved, they covered it the way they did to try to manipulate things. Because essentially they created a narrative. And they created, and when I say narrative, I literally mean they created their own reality that really didn't exist. And from a lot of people, they only mentioned the people that the government media mentioned that got killed, not all the other hundreds, thousands of other people. They only focused on the ones the government media nationally focused on. Now, again, locally, if someone's killed by a cop, usually you're going to probably see it on local news, but that's it. So if you don't live in that area, you're not going to hear about it unless you go. I mean, it's easy now. You can go to killed by police, I think .net, or killed by police on Facebook. They track them. So people are tracking all of this stuff now. But it was a total fucking power grab in a way. A total brainwash. And it's just so fucked up that that's what, you know, that's what the government does. They do whatever they need to do to push an agenda, whether it's create narratives or, you know, whatever. And I look at this almost like when the CIA goes into another country and starts a revolution, meaning they get the people to do it with operatives and all that whole thing. That's kind of what they did. And it's just so fucked up. Because the whole police thing, it's like, you know, even people that are harassed by police or whatever, it's like they try the association with, you know, race and police. And then if you're not black, it doesn't exist. So the police are great to you or whatever. I don't know. And associating that, some people might not even talk about it because of the fact that it's so much associated with race now. And the fucked up thing, too, is this has been going on forever. People just didn't know about it. Police have been killing people since police started. It's just, as I was saying earlier, we didn't have the internet. We didn't have smartphones and things like that. So it's, where do you go from here? And, you know, I still believe in noncompliance. And noncompliance is the people that try to get you to comply are the police. And hopefully, and I don't think it's the majority of black people that believe the bullshit. You know, that's what they show you on the news. That's what they focus on. Because they focus on their narrative. And that's what they do. So that's what you're going to see. But I don't think the majority of people that fall for that shit. And, you know, but they keep trying to fucking, you know, push it on no matter where you go. That's, they take that, what the police say, as the people that believe them, or the people on the other side, the conservatives, whatever. The police supporters, they take what the police say as fact and they just run with it. And it's just, it's crazy. And it's like police and race are forever associated now. And again, it's not like we didn't know the police were killed black people at a higher rate or harassed black people at a higher rate in black neighborhoods and things like that. I mean, fuck the police came out in 1988. You know, it's not like this shit hasn't been going on forever. So it's hard what to, I mean, they obviously do a good job when, and when I say good job, I'm not saying what they're doing is good, but they accomplish their agenda. They do it well, fucking manipulating the public and, you know, creating these narratives and pushing them down the throats of people. But people got to realize that it's all bullshit. And the fucking injustice system is bullshit. The police, the politicians, the government in general. And it doesn't matter who you are, unless, you know, you're part of the powers that be. Nobody's safe from the police or the government, despite what you may think. But hopefully people can come together, as initially I think people did, but, and I think a lot of people, you know, just because they gave this narrative, you know, there were people that were there for other reasons, you know, and people that were just, it was about the police. And I'm not talking about coming together like people that support Black Lives Matter. I'm talking about coming together against the government and coming together against the police and all of those things. And not based on fucking socialism, based on the fact that the government rules over you without consent, violates your freedoms and rights, your real rights, not your old this or your old that. Not that somebody's labor is owed to you. I'm talking about your freedom to own a gun, or your freedom to put what you want in your body, or your freedom to be left the fuck alone and not be harassed by police and not be forced to pay taxes at the point of a gun and not have everything forced on you by violence, because every law is backed by violence. And who backs that violence? The police. The police affect everybody negatively, not just Black people. Even though, yes, there is racism and there are police that discriminate, especially in Black neighborhoods. But it's, people don't see it a lot, now, a lot of people, but they will soon. They'll see the police state for what it is. But by that time, it may be too late, because they're sitting there arguing about race and how the police aren't racist, or they are racist, or whatever. If they didn't exist, it wouldn't matter, because there'd be no police to be racist or not racist or whatever. So that's all the time we have for today. I appreciate everybody for tuning in. And if you missed any part of the show, of course, go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com for all the places that you can hear the show. Spreaker is usually the best place, but there's a lot of other places if you're on there. So check it out wherever you have an account. All right, thanks everybody. Have a good night.
Police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something,